Well, being 7 o'clock, I'll start the meeting. Called order, introduce the board members. We have Kelly Kelcher, Ann Bauer, Kurt Karbuski, Linda Yu, Paul Kenny, happy anniversary. Myself, Bob Green, Superintendent George Mavrolis, Annette Ashley, Sean Hyland, Todd Smith, Assistant Superintendent Sherry Syra, and Director of Business Services Lori Ames. At this particular time, I'll be looking for approval of minutes, regular minutes of September 12, 2016. Any questions, concerns, any items to be pulled? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Communications, citizen comments. You have any citizens who'd like to address the board?
Class project, so.
Welcome. Oh, it's an open meeting, but if you have any further questions that you have, please feel free to ask any board member here. We'd be very happy to help you out. Okay, correspondent to board communications.
I just want to mention that Bob and I had the opportunity to attend the Region 12 annual WASB meeting, which was a great evening. Great way to interact with other board members from around the region. A great way to meet the WASB staff, you know, get to know them a little better. They also had a workshop on how to conduct board meetings, so we learned all the things we were doing wrong. No, just kidding. But no, it was a great presentation. You know, several of the executive director and some other folks gave presentations. But a couple things that, couple takeaways. They were talking about boards monitoring school district activities and, you know, that being one of our responsibilities. And, of course, they talked about getting teacher feedback, staff feedback, and feedback from the public. But they also mentioned, which I think is something we didn't always think about, is getting surveys for students and getting student feedback, kind of exit interviews from seniors, you know, doing some sort of a collection of feedback from the students. There was also a legislative update from the lobbyist for WASB, and gave some information which I thought was useful to bring up now. It's information from the nonpartisan Legislative Fiscal Bureau, which is the nonpartisan arm of the legislature, the assembly. And what they pointed out, which, you know, there's kind of a lot of newspaper articles right now or things in the press about how the state aid has increased to schools, which is true. There's been a very slight, like a 0.5% increase in state aid. So the headlines say, you know, basically more money for schools. But what they pointed out, what the LFB pointed out, is that, in fact, they put out a memo recently, which points out that there's actually been zero adjustment to the revenue limits. There's been a zero increase in per pupil aid for 15-16. So essentially what this amounts to is a tax shift. It's not more money for schools. It's a tax shift from property taxes, which is good because people's taxes will go down, but then it's to the state. The state is making up that revenue, and so there's actually more money taken away in form of income taxes and from the state budget for other purposes. So just a misunderstanding that needs to be, I think, pointed out and kind of spread around a little bit.
While speaking to that, where they were talking about monitoring, and so I had mentioned one of the things that we do is the roundtable as a way of, as a monitoring, and I actually got a couple of questions on that from the moderator as well as some other board members on what this meant, and, you know, how they considered monitoring. I said, well, this was a very useful feedback tool for the board members, having one board member sit at each table with different teachers and employees coming in. It gave us an ability to monitor and also work with and have a first-hand view. And
from what I understood, we were the only school in the area that was doing that, and there were a lot of people who found that very interesting, and we're going to be taking a second look at that. So I did receive some positive feedback on what we're doing there. So again, hats off to everybody here. It's something that we've been using, I think, as a very useful tool. We have to come up with next board meeting.
Next board meeting.
Yes, sir.
Over 550 kids that trunk or treated on last Friday. So it was a huge event, and 40 families sponsored cars. Lots of the staff was at the event. It was a great night. We had nice weather. So, and they had the food trucks to also earn some money too. So it was a great time.
Anything else? A couple of
couple things. A couple weeks ago, had attended the Glacier Oaks Estates annual board meeting. It's just our community's annual meeting, and spoke about the anticipated reduction in the mill rate, as well as the kickoff for the long-range planning committee. Word out there. Also attended the Park Elementary Food Truck Movie Night. And this Thursday and Friday, I will be attending the WASB WSAA School Law Seminar in at the Colorado.
Nothing really, just wanted to mention, I saw George's presentation at the Chamber of Commerce, Good Moving Middleton meeting, which was great. Also, by all accounts, the shortest and most to-the-point update that that organization has ever had.
I have something.
Yes, please.
Just kudos to Mr. Bartman at the middle school. This was the, he coordinates the cross-country activity there in the fall. Friday is the last day, so anytime that you have a huge number of students that are turning out and you have a very limited, I think it's like four, they have two for each grade that actually act as the coach, and the kids have a fabulous season, I think that is cause for celebration and for acknowledgement. So again, kudos to him.
I have one more thing I wanted to bring up then. I had a conversation with Jim Blodgett before the board meeting in reference to some of the large increase we've had in spam emails to the board website. So he sent me a communication on why this is occurring, how this is occurring, and I'll forward that email on to the rest of the board, and then I'd like to put it as an agenda item, bring it to the agenda committee, and discuss some options which may or may not be able to help with that. But when you get this email from me, from Jim Blodgett, you'll know what it's going on. But I've noticed a large increase in the amount of spam that we've been receiving. So, you know, we've talked just a little bit, and there's a couple options. So I think the board should probably have a small discussion about it before we move forward.
It's just the board getting those? I guess.
No, we all are.
Yeah.
Right. But there's a portal that they're coming to the board through that's unique to the board. So the ones that are coming to the board are from other places because they're coming through this portal. So I'll talk about that. And that's one of the things that Jim talked to me about. So I'll send an email.
Sent us an update during this meeting.
Right.
A long one. Yeah.
Yep. That's the one. So
perfect.
Well, just to it to you and me, to mm-hmm. go to the rest of the board.
Yep.
So you'll get a copy of that and you know what's going on. At this point in time, I don't have anything else. Superintendent?
Yes. We have our first official board visits to schools on Friday. Park and Glacier Creek are welcoming you. And what would be helpful to us, and Cheryl, if you all said, or do you want me to take the... We want to find out who is planning on coming, just so that we can let the schools know about how many to expect. So we have... Kurt?
I won't be able to...
They're open all day, and so you can come at any time. They're expecting you at any point in time. So maybe if you kind of can tell us morning, afternoon, all day kind of thing. So let's just start, you know, Kurt's coming and?
Morning.
Primarily morning. Yeah. Ann?
Yeah.
Primarily any particular, probably morning?
I can do Friday morning.
Friday morning. Kelly, great. Linda?
I probably come with Kurt since I need a ride, and also I need to wait for my wheelchair to get here.
Okay. Morning then. Morning for you. Paul?
Morning as well.
Morning?
I'll be in Texas,
yep.
Sorry.
I will be there in the morning as well. I have superintendents, Dean County superintendents in the afternoon, so I'll be morning.
I have a conflict.
Conflict?
I have the conference,
yep.
So I won't be able to make it.
Yeah, I'll come in the morning.
Great.
Sure.
So you can come to spend part of your time at Park, spend part of your time at Glacier Creek. Fantastic. That's a great turnout.
That
is really positive. The staff will really be thrilled. So you have all that, Cheryl?
Yep.
Thank you.
Show up, but you know,
yep. Something. Now I'll let the principals know who all's coming and about how many, and then the staff know you're coming. So the principals may say, "Here's some things you might want to see while you're here." Otherwise, the rooms are wide open to come in. And what I like to do is I like to sit down with kids and ask them, hey, what are you doing? Tell me what you're working on. Because then the teacher can keep doing what they're doing, and then find out, you know, how that's going. So, that's just a nice, easy way to ease in. So that's Friday. The second thing is I had a one-on-one meeting with John Ashley Friday after your meeting on Thursday. It was kind of a get acquaintance meeting, and we had a great conversation. Very complimentary of all of you as a board and what you're doing and our relationship, board-superintendent relationship. Very complimentary of what he learned from Kurt and Bob the night before, and really good organization to partner with, and they think very highly of us as well. So great conversation. And then third, I think this is really interesting. Tomorrow we're having our planning session for our third partnership for student support and success that's coming up next week. And the students are helping plan the next meeting on the committee. So they're starting to take more ownership, which I think is really, that's the pivot that we were hoping for. And so we're freeing them out of class tomorrow to join us in co-planning for the next session. And part of what they want to do is come up with a little survey for all the students. They say, you know, there's four of us here, but we don't represent all the voices. And this is them talking to the group last time. And they said, we need to hear from all of us. So they are going to come to help develop a little survey that can be administered during advisory so that all the student voices are heard as well. So just wanted to share that with you because I think getting the students to kind of start owning that is exactly what we had hoped for. So it's happening. So those are my three items tonight.
Okay. Thank you very much for that. Moving on to consent agenda. Offering for board's approval, 5A1, approval of bills payable, 5B1, approval of resignations, 2, approval of leave of absence, 3, approval of staff appointments, and C1, approval of memorandum of understanding for CBITS. Any items that need to be pulled? Any items to discuss? Questions? Okay. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you for that. Okay. Items for information discussion, facilities condition report.
In your packet, you will see a facilities planning conditioning report that we put together for the facilities here in the district. Originally, when we started putting this together, it was to have a document that would go to the facility planning committee to help provide them information on the buildings that we have currently in our district, the land that we own, you know, what we've done to kind of maintain them, and also to identify things that we've thought about or thought about in the past in terms of what we might want to do in the future. And so this was just a kind of a way to bring that all together for them. What we found out as we were creating it is that we really can use it for a lot of different purposes. One, it's great information for all of you in terms of our buildings so that when you get questions or things like that, you have information at your fingertips. It's also going to be great if we went out for bid on our insurances 2 years ago, but we will be at some point again, and a lot of the information that's in that document is everything that they need in order to be able to provide us an accurate quote on our insurances. The other piece that I think is going to be helpful is that one of the subjective things that are that is reviewed, judged, valued in a Moody's rating is what kind of job we do in terms of monitoring district activity, focusing on taking care of, planning for, whether that's enrollment, facilities, any of the things in the district to show that we have sound leadership, sound management. And I think having this document available to show them that we do that and we look at it on a regular basis will help in that subjective rating. So this is a document that while it originally started out to be for that facility planning group is one we're going to maintain throughout the years so that the board can have access to the most recent information on our buildings. And as time goes on, we might find things that we want to add to it, but I think this was a really great first start in terms of pulling information together. So
talked about before was if you do get an opportunity to delve into this a little deeper, let's take a look at the Pulp Farm report and talk a little bit more about property, because for many of the newer board members here, Pope Farm has never been a topic of discussion. I mean, for some board members, there was awareness of the fact that we had that property. So take a look at that. Certainly think about what the property is like. We may try and look up what we actually had a plan for the 2009 referendum, I think it was, where we actually had type of a showing how the property was being used. One quick note, when you do see that, we had done something different on that particular property than we've done with other ones. We had actually identified 5 residential sites that we would sell at a later date that were next to existing sites as just either means of raising a small amount of revenue, but it was something totally different than we've ever done before with sites. So perhaps if we can get a copy, we talked about that during the Finance Committee meeting, was getting, you know, just to how the site was used. It'll give you a feel for what, how Mel Pope and how that group wanted that property to be done, and they were very specific about where things were going to be and how it would be used. So I think, Lori, what did you say, 2 binders worth of documents?
There was 3 folders of information to review, and then the final documents were a binder of about this big. So there's a lot of activity that took place in order to make that happen in terms of making sure that we met the requirements. There was stuff that had to be done with the town of Middleton as well as the DNR and a variety of different agencies to make that all happen.
Definitely part of our growth plans in the future, because we do have that area. Well, it's a lot of good information. You guys did a great job on that. And I know myself, I've actually printed off, and I'm going to hang on to this just so I can refer back to it as well. So I do want to.
There's a lot of people that were involved in gathering the information, and Jeannie Butzik was the one that put it all together. Organized, so kudos to her for the help she gave on that.
Point out that at the next Facilities Planning Committee meeting, this is a big chunk of that night where we will go school by school, so that the committee is very well aware of what currently exists, the age of the buildings, capacity, you know. And so if anybody wants to kind of hear that type of detail, you're certainly welcome to come to the next FPC if you want to just sit and listen, because that's really where we'll break it down and have, they'll ask a lot of questions. So
what's the date?
Tuesday, October 18th, 6:30 to 8:30 at Cromery.
Right. We'll also be doing a tour of Cromery in there, because FPC wanted to move the meetings to all of our buildings and to really tour them. So I'm guessing the bulk of that night will be focused on Cromery, and then the next meeting will be at a different school. So great.
Okay. Any further questions? Follow up on the facilities condition report. Again, thank you. It's a tremendous amount of information. Report on third Friday enrollment. A little good news.
Okay, so this is a very detailed description of how we count students. Which you're never going to have to be responsible for, but I put it in there for 2 reasons. One, for you to see the different types of students that we have, residents versus non-residents versus part-time residents versus open enrollment, you know, all the little factors that we have to track in order to get down to the number of students that we're actually able to count for revenue limit purposes and aid purposes. So it essentially takes our head count in our building, it subtracts out any students who are residents but they're not full-time. So students like our homeschooled students, where they're only coming for maybe 2 classes a day, those are pulled out of the count. We do get aid for them, but we're not allowed to count them for revenue limits. We also have to subtract out any non-residents we're serving. We do get paid for the non-residents we serve, but we get paid via another school district, not from the revenue limit, or not in the revenue limit. And then we have to add in all those students that are resident students that are being served elsewhere So our open enrollment out students were allowed to count because they're our residents and we're paying for the cost of their instruction. When we go all the way down to the bottom and add in our Youth Challenge Academy student, because we also pay for that student's program there, we have an FTE of 6,942. That is 232 FTE greater than last year. Which is wonderful. I mean, well, you know, in terms of we are able to do a lot of the things that we are able to do because of our enrollment growth. But when you look at a revenue limit is based on a three-year average. So we're only able to factor in a third of that growth with two other higher years of enrollment. So our FTE for revenue limit purposes actually only went up 191, which is still much greater than many school districts in this state. So I'm not downplaying that at all. But there is very much a difference between what our actual FTE is and what we're allowed to do for revenue limits. And one of the reasons why they do that is because it helps stabilizes out your counts. Because if you happen to be a district that maybe does this, where you're growing and then dropping and growing and dropping, trying to manage a budget is very difficult. But if they kind of average it out, then it provides a little bit more stability for the district to work with.
But on that, our this year and last year are two highest of our three,
yeah,
by far. So if we get another 200 next year, then that number will,
yes,
really jump up.
Exactly.
Yeah, for exactly. Next year.
So just kind of being aware that that's the difference. Now, one of the things that you're going to hear is that we didn't necessarily have a headcount increase of 232. We actually had a headcount increase of less than that, although I don't know what the number is. And as I explained to the Finance Committee, the reason why there's a difference is because the makeup of the students are different. We had less non-residents to subtract out this year because we had less open enrollment in students. So that impacts our FTE calculation as opposed to just the total number of kids that came. So I'll let you take over from here, Sherry. Right.
So then you saw the report that is probably easier to understand, which is the official Third Friday, like, head count in terms of students actually in our schools. So one of the things that I did, because these are numbers, they're not drastically different than what you've seen before. It starts with the projected and then goes into the actual enrollment on the Third Friday, and then actual versus projected. But one of the things, because we had schools that were up significantly, is I looked at last year's Third Friday versus this year's to just see, while we know where we are in terms of projection, where did we actually grow numbers of students? There aren't any major surprises there. Glacier Creek and Northside were both up 38 students. So those were the two schools that had the most students more than last year. After that, West Middleton and Cromrie was 32, West Middleton 28, and Sauk Trail 27. And those three elementaries that were up so much are the places where we added a section at some point. And so again, that's because of that growth of 27 to 38. At Glacier and Cromrie, while we grew quite a bit, we anticipated even more growth there. So we had the staff to address that growth. The high school was up 28. So just kind of to give you some perspective on what it looked like versus Third Friday of last year. And then those enrollment trend charts are the same, the overall trend. We're still significantly above previous years, and then broken down by elementary, middle, and high school. And you'll notice too from the the last report to the actual Third Friday dropped, and that's typical also because we have students who haven't withdrawn but then don't show up at the beginning of the year, and it takes a couple weeks to kind of track down, have they enrolled somewhere else, and when we can actually withdraw them. And so usually that dip is from students who have moved, but we weren't notified until they enrolled somewhere else, or we were trying to track that down.
I just had a question, and I know that
Yes. So that's one of the things that we've talked with Jill about, and they're very aware of as well in terms of communicating with families and trying to work on that messaging with families, and that we've been working on with them.
We're actually talking about even potentially bigger changes of making, blurring the lines a little bit more between Middleton High School and Clark Street, where maybe students would want a seminar project-based experience where you wouldn't have to completely leave the high school to get it. And so we're in that early stages so that, because I think there'll be multiple benefits if we go down that road. Jill's very open to it. Steve's very open to it. We have another, we call it visioning session, coming up, I think it's next week or this week, where we're going to continue to talk about that. And I think by the time we get to December, January, we'll have some ideas to bring to the board. Just say, here are some thoughts for next year about the Clark Street Middleton High School situation, because we are concerned. And I think the when we talked to families, and a lot of families who came to the open houses and, you know, came to different events were very interested, but when it came time to, but that means I have to like completely switch schools, that's where people get hesitant. And they're like, is there a way that for part of the day, you know, my child can come into a seminar type class? Or, and so we're kind of trying to meet the needs of the families too and what they're telling us. So that's kind of what we're exploring. Yeah.
And we have come really shy of that goal.
Yep, absolutely.
Pretty significant.
Yep, capacity is 120.
I'm also concerned about how many students we're serving that aren't even district kids there. So, I mean, we only have 14 kids in the ninth grade there, and how many are even district kids?
Yeah, we're getting those numbers. Bob asked for that during finance, and so we have an email to Kathy Spahn, our registrar, to get a breakdown of open enrollment versus resident at Clark Street and the high school. So we'll share that information with you.
Mm-hmm. I thought there was something already going on where you could take some classes at high school and some at Clark.
Yes.
We looked at that for one of our kids.
It only goes one way.
Okay.
If you're at Clark Street, you can take up two classes at the high school. But if you're at the high school, there's no way to plug into Clark Street. And so we're looking at that second pathway going the other direction as well. Yep, you're dead on. Yep.
And thank you, Ann, because the concerns that you had raised were similar ones that I'd raised during mm-hmm. the Finance Committee. So.
Yep.
Anything else in terms of Third Friday enrollment? Very good news. Obviously, we're moving in the right direction. One of the things that I'd asked about is if you took a look on the open enrollment report that we've received for Third Friday, the second page, I believe, was it the first
page? On the first page.
It's on the first page. You look at fifth grade, total elementary, where is that at? Anyway, at fifth grade, we no longer have right here.
Yep, there it is.
So at the bottom where it says subtract, non-residential, fifth grade, we were at zero. So most likely next year when we'll see sixth grade, we'll probably see that number will be zero or
correct.
Possibly one. And so each time that happens, you, Laurie, mentioned the fact that we had less of a negative subtraction in terms of that. So even though our head count may not have been as large, we actually received a boost by having less open enrollment students. So that decision that we made on that will also have some financial, positive financial impacts for us, as well as just in addressing our space needs as well too. So there are some secondary effects from that decision we made.
Well, if we if the board makes a similar decision in January this year that you made last year, where it says open enrollment, you know, building, those cannot go up. They'll only go down if they move out or they move into the district and they become residents. So those numbers will not go up. So the 126, the TTL, 126, well, when the 31 graduate, we're going to be, you know, below 100 and then possibly even less, because what we're finding are several families that were here under open enrollment that hit the fourth to fifth actually sold their homes and moved. and became residents, and that's why our resident count jumped to 234.
And George, so, just to be careful, probably part of that 31 is there's probably a large number of Clark Street in there, and some of those may not graduate. You know, cause those,
oh, potential.
Yeah. Right, yeah. Yeah. So that's where I was trying to figure out the number on open enrollment for Clark Street. Yeah.
It was, we had that same question last year, and it wasn't real high, so I don't think a lot of those 31 are open enrollment, but we'll get those numbers tomorrow.
Cool. But no, this is very good news. I mean, we're struggling for every dollar we can get right now. Plus, we do have a new budget year coming up from the state, and the early indicators aren't very favorable in terms of seeing increases, large increases for revenue limit increases. The state is struggling as well. We don't seem to be top of the list in terms of extra funding for K-12 school districts. Anything else, Third Friday? Any questions? Review of permanent substitute teachers. Tabitha.
I certainly can.
We're going
to and so how the permanent sub positions are used and have been established at the different levels has varied. So I'll provide some background, and then Tabitha will talk through the costing information that she sent you. During the 14-15 school years, when we were experiencing sub shortages, as were schools everywhere, and we added mid-year permanent subs, one at the high school, one at the middle level, shared between the two middles, and then two at the elementary schools. So three schools shared one, and three schools shared a second sub. When we set them up at the elementary school, because the elementaries are in a six-day rotation, the subs had 2 days of each of those rotations at an elementary school, and then if they weren't needed there, other schools could call to say, we have a need. That's not as efficient or as smooth a process as it is at the middles, where every A day they're at one, every B day they're at the other, or at the high school where Michelle Drazen knows, I always have a sub to plug in. So the kind of plugging in wasn't as efficient at the elementary school, because if they're assigned, say, at Park one day, any of the other schools might end up then calling to say, if you don't need them, we could. And so it didn't work out as easily at the elementaries. Last year then, because we had a reduction in number of sections, and we had two specials teachers and a math specialist that were not full-time, instead they allocated that FTE to those three staff members, thinking, people who are already in our district, this keeps them full time, and they know our schools, they know our system, and so they're kind of ready to go. So they started again at a certain school. If they weren't needed there, then the other schools could call. Again, because it's the 6 day rotation, one of the things that happens is it's not always as easy in the offices to keep track of, it's day three, so we called this school to see, and so there end up being more days that didn't get used fully, whereas at the middles and high schools, we were using those fully. When we started working on the special schedule for elementary school in the spring, we hit a point where we have 5 section grade levels at 3 of our schools, and we knew that Sauk and Northside were close. And when we have 5 sections in a grade level, it means we need to have a specialist, one of the specials teachers there, 5 days, so that each of those classes can go to art, right? Because they're all at the same time. And so we needed to add FTE, and that's one of the decisions that the elementary level made, was in order to fund those, we would use that sub time and make those positions full time again. And then with those additional sections at West, North, and Sauk Trail, we now have 5 schools that have to run 5 days of specials. So that specials FTE has been used, but we no longer have the sub positions at the elementary level. We still do at the middle and high school level, and they'll continue to work very well. So And then Tabitha can talk about the costing differential.
And I would just add to the middles and the high school both track when they use their people and what positions they're putting them into. So Michelle Drazen, for example, at the high school has a binder, which she pulled out and showed me, and she can look back on any given day and tell me exactly which class he was plugged into on every given period. So it is well laid out that way. When running the costs and looking at the costs, I shared that document with you up front. If we hire a day-to-day sub who we purchase from Teachers on Call as our third-party provider for that service, that cost would be in the neighborhood of just under $30,000. I believe the number was about 28, 27.
531.
So when we bring them on as an employee in the permanent sub situation, we do a couple of things. One, we increase our cost in terms of the amount we pay per day, because while we don't place them on the salary schedule for the teachers, what we do pay them is the long-term rate, which goes up to $150 a day. So their rate of pay is slightly higher. However, that in and of itself would not be a great discrepancy for the overall annual cost. The big discrepancy comes in the form of benefits. And so for a staff member who picks up family insurance, for example, that person will add almost $20,000 in additional costs between the benefits that we add for that individual. If they only pick up single, the cost is probably more like around $6,000 or $7,000. So the gap can be pretty significant. Currently, we have one of our permanent subs that we have on staff who takes family insurance. The other one doesn't take any insurance at all. So the two average out pretty well, but that's just sort of the nature of where we're at. And the person who doesn't take benefits could pick them up at any point in time if they were to lose the current coverage that they have and need to add something more. So that risk is always there from a budget standpoint. I spell that out mostly because you asked, but reality is I think it's just good information for us to have. I still think that that money, after talking with all the principals at the different levels, I believe that that's a good investment to make at our secondary buildings, because they have been able to figure out a very efficient model. The only real way that I could say that I think that model would truly work at the elementary school would really be almost putting a permanent sub in every single building. Maybe sharing them between two buildings, because we've proven that at the middle school level that can be efficient. But given our limited resources and where we're at, I'm not sure that the totality of that investment is something that makes sense for us from a budget standpoint right now. So ultimately, that's your decision. And you know, if you were to say we really want to go back that direction, we certainly could explore it. But I truly think we would need to add a minimum of at least three in order for that to be an efficient process at the elementary school level. And I have not discussed that with the principals at that level, but Sherry and I have talked a little bit, and that really is pretty much where we're at from processing with them earlier in the year. So I don't know if anybody has any other questions about that information.
I experienced this in a district that I worked in Arizona. We had permanent subs, and it was a beautiful system for continuity for students. And when we talk about doing the right things for kids, this is one of those doing the right things for kids. The last 2 years, my son's teacher left mid-year, piecemealed together the last 2 years of school. If we had this in place, that wouldn't be something that we'd be facing on a regular basis. We would already have somebody who knows the curriculum, someone who's been in the building and knows kids, someone who already has relationships with the staff that can come in and teach those students.
You want to
respond to that? No, I'm just saying, because I've
seen
it.
It is good.
Play.
I mean, it's a very positive thing. I guess it just comes down to when we budget for next year, if adding permanent subs is a priority, we just have to know that it's about a $20,000 add to the budget per sub. That's all. That's all. We just need to have that and build it in and budget for it. So,
I would echo what Ann says. I'm familiar with some situations that I've heard about where there wasn't the continuity that the parents and the students would have liked, and that was detrimental. And I think at a certain point, you can't put a price on the continuity. And if you're that one student or family or that one class that doesn't have that continuity, then there's a price to be paid in terms of the education they're getting. And so I think it is something that would be important.
I have a question. I know you described how the situation currently is, the fact that the middles sharing, the high school having them, and then the shared basis at the elementary level. Is that the same type, even though you've had some issues at the elementary level, is that the same type of model you would recommend moving forward with, or would there be adjustments within that, just in terms of from a budgeting perspective?
I mean, I think we haven't tried it with the three positions. I think if we wanted to utilize them well, my hunch would be that we'd need to look at the three so that a school knows, like, we have even days, you have odd days, and it's not multiple schools calling the, you know, when there's one admin assistant in a school office in the morning, and multiple schools are calling in to see if you have a, you know, it, we're just not set up to handle that well. And I think between two schools, that certainly is easier. I mean, I think that would potentially be a better model than trying to share across multiple schools. But it would still be a budget add, because this year we don't have any at the elementary.
You could go, I mean, just to clarify, you could hire one, and they get placed first, regardless of which school. I mean, we could go that route.
There's one other option. If we went that option and we hired one, we could give them to Jane.
Right, that's what I meant.
Instead of to the elementaries. They could be the last one placed to fill gaps, but Jane would be, they would come here to the District Services Center first every morning, and we would then deploy them to wherever it is that we need to fill the hole. I really think if we go with one, that's the only possible option. We tried to not do that because we wanted them to be automatically in the building so they could most quickly plug in.
Like I said, ideally you go like three, but I'm saying if one's better than none, we could start with one.
That would be the only way we could try to do one.
And then Jane would decide this is where and communicate out to the building.
Ask a question, and one of the differences that I'm seeing here between the daily subcost and the perm subcost is obviously as we're working here, there's not a benefit. So I'm taking it teachers on calls doesn't pay benefits, or they're more as a part-time employee, they're paying them at a lower rate.
They do pay benefits. They have a very different benefit structure, and the eligibility for them to qualify for benefits is fairly high. So not very many of the subs qualify for benefits. If we put them on and they're full-time every day, they qualify automatically for ours, based on the Affordable Care Act and the rules and structures there. Teachers on Call is, because they're a placement agency, they're a 12-month agency, so the eligibility is quite a bit more in terms of what they need to work to hit that threshold. Correct.
Where I was kind of going with this question is that I'm assuming that the people that they're using are all qualified. Is that correct? Either through one way or another, either being former teachers or having an educational standards?
Yeah, they are hiring is the exact same process we would have gone through.
So
not all teachers.
Well, they weren't all teachers when we hired them either.
Right, but if we hired on our own, we would be looking to hire certified teachers.
Well, I don't mean to disagree, but I will, because we had even on our existing list a number of teachers who have substitute permits through DPI. They all have that qualification because all substitutes to receive a substitute permit or a substitute license have to have a four-year degree. And if they don't have the four-year degree in teaching, they must have completed a training program that provides minimum requirements for teaching. And so all of them have gone through that requirement and met DPI standard for being able to be substitute teachers. We had a number of those on our list lots of those on our list, even before we went with teachers on call.
But we didn't hire those employees for.
But not in long-term positions.
No, they can never work in long-term positions, and that rule isn't any different now either. We still have to follow DPI's rules. They can't be, the current statute says that they cannot be in a classroom for more than 45 days. The prior statute was more than 20.
We would need to hire certified teachers because there is a potential that they would be in a classroom for longer than 45 days.
Or permanent subpositions, yes. I'm sorry, I misunderstood what you were saying. I thought you were talking about for even our day-to-day.
Oh, no. I know the teachers on call does not have that.
Because we were talking about TLC, I was thinking that's what it meant. They do have to be fully licensed.
Where I'm going with this, and bear with me for just a minute or two, and you can tell me if I'm going out. In my other stages of my life, I've worked at a temp agency. I have just a basic idea. Obviously, now, first of all, are they able to fill all the positions? There used to be a shortage where they had a hard time sometimes even filling our positions, other positions. Are they fully staffed up now? Do they have enough people to cover all positions when you need somebody?
There isn't a district in the country that's at that stage, quite frankly, just because of supply and demand. But I will say that our fill ratio has been at or above the area districts in the Dane County area. When I've done that comparison with my colleagues, we are at least the same in terms of percentage of fill or higher.
So can I comment on that? Because sure. You see where the 115 pay rate? Districts set that rate. And so every district has a different rate, even though they work for teachers on call. If they sub here, they get $115. If they sub in another district, they may only get $110. So that's why our fill rate's a little higher, because we were the highest or at the highest, because you need to be there, because if they get two or three calls, they tend to take the one that's going to pay the most. So sure. We do control that amount.
We always stay right on that top edge of that.
Yeah.
Where I'm going with this idea is that what Ann is asking for, as well as Kurt, is that we're looking for the better qualified teachers. Okay, and this is on the other side, teachers on call is a temp agency. More so than anything, they're specializing in particular, like nurses, somebody like. Is there a possibility that we can ask and look for to develop possibly a couple of highly qualified people who work inside their group? And maybe not at 115, maybe at 120, and we say that we can give them work for a certain period of time and ask for and request one or two individuals on a yearly basis, and then we ask that we get a higher priority and maybe pay a little bit more in answering some of the concerns that you have, keep these people in our district on a more regular basis. I'm just asking.
You're not trained in curriculum, so you're losing that entire benefit.
Well, finished, if we turn around and say we'll spend a couple of days extra above and beyond in training and curriculum if they agree to work for us on hybrid. I'm just throwing this out. I'm just asking a question. There's some benefit for using them teachers on call. Is there a way we can work around that as well to our advantage?
I was going to say, can you differentiate the 115?
Well, so here's the catch that will occur.
That's why I'm asking.
Yes, you can differentiate the 115. And we do, because we pay our long-term subs through them they're licensed.
So that is possible,
and
then.
Done. The one dilemma that we have is if they do qualify for insurance through teachers on call, those costs get transferred to the district. So I don't know that we're in any better shape for somebody that
ourselves.
We're hiring on an ongoing basis. I would strongly prefer, if we're going that direction, that we would bring them on as our staff member. We then can evaluate. We then can make all the decisions we need in terms of professional development and so forth, and make those mandated versus that becoming something that they could choose to plug into or not. So I think in the long run, that would be still our better bet, is to get them on as staff if we go that direction again.
We have a variety of needs to fill. One of those that you, Anna, had referred to was the somebody left and we need them to fill in for the entire year. Another one would be if somebody was, say, on a prolonged illness type situation where we needed somebody in place for 2 to 4 weeks. So there's a variety of type of situations. I'm not saying that necessarily just one box that we put it in and say that's the only box we're going to be looking at using, but there's obviously different sets of criteria. I'm just looking at this, okay, this is a temp agency. You know, they work for us. Is there a way that we can perhaps leverage our ability to pay and use a little bit more if we found some highly qualified subs who could fit inside our criteria? perhaps even teachers who had worked here once in the past, asking a question, not making a statement.
I'll just kind of repeat what some of the things that have already been said. I think to play into Ann's point a little bit, I think it's true that, you know, whether it's food service, whether it's bus drivers, whenever you're, you know, you always have a little more control. You have more control over flies flying around your face, over the type of people that you're going to hire for those positions than if it's a temp agency or whatever that, you know, whether it's bus drivers or food service or subs. I think also that it would be easier to fill some of those positions if they're permanent with our benefits. Our benefits are very attractive to people who want to come here and work full time. So I think we'd have a higher rate of being able to fill some of those positions. I'm not so sure I agree with you, Bob, in terms of trying to work with the temp agency to fill our criteria. I think that's kind of doing it maybe a little bit half-baked. I think we'd be, you know, I think you seem to agree with us that we'd be better, if we are going to go that route, we'd be better off making them full employees and just, you know.
Just a quick counter on that. They're going to be in our school system whether we give them a preferential payment and we train them a little higher or not. So the question I have is, if you're looking to increase the quality of the people who are going to be here, do we make a deliberate effort or not? That's the only reason I'm asking that question.
I mean, teachers on call includes people that don't have an education degree. If we hire our own people, that would be something that we would prioritize.
Back in here again, our whole goal of this step up in this program would be to eliminate that group of people and identify just on a small group of individuals who we would want to have in our schools at all time. So that's what I was thinking.
I don't know why they would be interested in working for us through teachers on call in that regard.
There's a lot of people out there who don't necessarily want to work full time, and which would look at this for a variety of reasons.
This is full time
now. No, that's where you and I are probably getting off base a little bit. Not all of our needs are full time needs. Sometimes they're going to plug into a school for one day here, they're going to plug into another school for another day.
With the permanent sub position, the concept is they work every day, they're guaranteed work every day, and if we don't have a placement for them, then there's an alternate assignment for additional support that they're provided. However, we've never really had to deal, I mean, other than at the elementary, we've had a few unused days.
But if
we don't have a fail to fill in a teacher position, we almost always will in a para, and they will be assigned to paras as well if need be. And the other item is, even if we're full at 8 o'clock in the morning, the number of staff that we have, it's almost guaranteed that someone will get a call by 10 that their child is sick at school or something and need to leave. So while they may have an alternate assignment for an hour or two, they're quickly plugged in somewhere. They would work every single day and they have to be available every single day for us.
Because at this point in time, what I'd heard was we were unable to make a permanent position work at the elementary. So obviously that solution wasn't working for the district, and I was trying to find alternatives for that.
But that was because of scheduling things. Like, they didn't have a consistent time that they were available. Like,
our teacher would have a couple hours or half day.
They were full days. But it's just that they might be at this school and where we're empty. You know what I mean? It was more the logistics of using them. We used full days, though, for the special teachers.
But using them didn't help if the teacher got sick and had to leave for the rest of the year. We couldn't pull the music teacher.
Right, because they were available two of the six days. Another one was available three.
Hearing the dialogue, it does make sense. I mean, having a permanent sub at the elementary level, at least one, if not two or three, does make sense. So I think we will absolutely, when we come to budgeting for 17-18, absolutely take a look at that. Because would it be nice to have, you know, one, two, or three permanent staff members go through our training, know our system, are there working every day, and if unfortunately we need them because of a situation, they're there. Totally agree. We tried to get through the summer without adding a lot to the budget, and I think for 17-18, I think we should revisit this. So,
if we were to hire multiple, the other add-on I would say is
we would try to look for a diverse group, meaning maybe one that's more lower elementary and one that's more upper elementary, so that we could have that spread. If we hire one and they're normally kindergarten or first grade and the opening happens at fourth, it's a little harder. Not impossible, but a little harder because they may or may not have the right training or the right background to even want that job. But I think if there's multiple, we can even differentiate further, which would be an added advantage, for sure.
Any further questions, concerns? Yes, go ahead.
And I think, as George mentioned, when we come up, when the time comes, when we plan the next budget, I think things like that need to be considered, and we can run some scenario analysis. And I know the class sizes has been increasing, so we have to look at whether we need to hire additional teachers, additional paras, additional, you know, permanent sub positions. And if our enrollment keep increasing, I think we might have the ability to pay for some of those positions. But I think at this year, we are very close to balance, right? Yeah. So we'll definitely include that in the future finance committee and bring back to the board. Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Problem with a growing district, you know, and this isn't just another way of looking at how to handle those problems and situations. So, okay, any further questions? By the way, good discussion. I think administration got a lot more out in terms of what the board was looking for.
Perfect.
Okay, calendar proposals. Ooh.
I'm going to turn over to Tabitha, but we talked at the district services team about getting the calendar out for next year, and then we said, well, let's get them out for 2 years because, you know, people like to have those. And so we brought these to our meeting a week ago Monday, took a look at concepts. I'm going to turn over to Tabitha. We are, again, going to let our families weigh in and select. We think that's a really good process. We've gotten great feedback. So there are kind of two concepts that Tabitha's going to talk about, the same kind of basic concepts that we've given the choices to for the last couple of years, is the longer winter break versus the slightly shorter winter break and the impacts of that. So I'm going to turn over to Tabitha.
So the obvious difference being that 2 weeks off at winter break versus not, the way the holidays fall over the next 2 years, it is kind of an opportune time if we were to go away from the two-week break. However, after having the two-week break for so long, I know a number of families probably are getting very used to that. So option A and option B have that difference in mind. Obviously, the main impact of that then is if we go to the two-week winter break, it pushes the end date of the school year in June. And the main thing we tried to do was make sure that we were still out before June 15th. We were able to accomplish that with both of those calendars. But we do think it's important for us to get that feedback from the community. Well, as I think the high school students maybe even also participated in a survey last year or the last time around. So our intent would be to put both A and B out to that survey process for both of the next 2 years, get some feedback from those constituents, and then factor that in terms of which direction we go. There's some little nuanced things that we would tidy up afterwards, such as, like, we showed you where professional development days, for instance, would fall. Those might be tweaked a little bit here or there, but none of those would extend the school year. It would be simply replacing another student day for the PD day and making a flip. So there might be some additional tweaks we would make to the drafts that you have, but the breaks for winter break and spring break are the consistencies that we'd be looking for feedback on in this survey.
You'll notice the A's have slightly shorter winter break, but then when you look in June, they end that first week, and the B's have the full 2 weeks, and then they spill over into the second week of June. So those are kind of the two main differences. The only other thing I'll point out is that for both years, the first day of school is after Labor Day. Now, you could start on the first, you could start on a Friday in 17-18, but we talked as a team, and we thought families might want to use that as a long, you know, maybe even plan a vacation in there, where then they can spill over into the Labor Day weekend. And so both years, the first day of school is the Tuesday after Labor Day.
The other piece that I forgot to mention that could be impacted depending upon if A or B is selected on at least one of the years, if not both, is what day would graduation be? Because we've been having graduation the Sunday before the last week in school, the last couple of years. And based on it wrapping to the second week, it would shift whether graduation was the Sunday right before. It would be almost impossible to go the Sunday before that and have seniors out for a week and a half. I just don't think that's very realistic. So the high school made sure that they pointed out to us that that does have a bearing on them specifically. So getting that feedback sooner than later would be good because they have to contract for their location, and they'll be needing to do that in the near future.
So I just want to point out again, this is a board decision, setting the calendar. The feedback that we collect from parents and staff is just feedback for you to consider, but ultimately you decide school calendar. So I just to be clear, you get to decide. But we'll get you some feedback so that you kind of know where people are at. Unless you don't want the feedback, but I assume you do. Yes, okay.
We'll get the feedback regardless. Okay. Yeah.
Before or after or both.
Yeah. So we'll gather the feedback and then we'll bring that to you.
Can I just ask, sure. This is a question that doesn't have to do with the break times or anything, but one of the things that I did hear several comments made on was in September, the kids had just gone back to school after Labor Day, and then it was right around the September 23rd or something, there was a professional development day. Mm-hmm. And I think that may have been different than in years past, and I know it was something that a lot of parents commented on, that, and I just was curious if it was in an attempt to make sure there were like one PD day a month, or, you know.
And I'll let Sherry, you can join in as well. From an educator perspective, having the PD in September is extremely helpful, especially when we're implementing new curriculum, for example, at the elementary level with the math curriculum, where we did our PD in August, then the teachers had 3 weeks to kind of, you know, get going, and then having that day, the feedback has been overwhelmingly positive from a teacher perspective on the September PD day because the timing is perfect. They felt if we waited all the way till October then to pull them together and say, how's it going? They just felt, oh my gosh, that is too long to wait. So I get the balance. There is a trade-off. It's probably harder on families, but that particular one is kind of important for the educators, whereas some of these other decisions we're making are easier for families. So,
could I make a suggestion?
Sure, absolutely.
That sort of messaging go into the announcement?
Yes.
Just because I think mm-hmm. that explains all of it, and if people knew that, I think that would make the difference in, you know, understanding why it's necessary and raising the question as to why they just got back to school. Why do we need a day off?
Perfect.
Which is how it came across when I received those comments. So, just
yeah, that's very helpful. Yeah. Thank you. It was
finally a 5-day week, and then we had a day off right after that. So that probably felt a little more awkward maybe than in the past. We have had a PD day that week for the last several years.
You know, and just...
This is the third year we've had the September day.
It is.
And that's probably why it felt so different.
But did we go earlier?
Well, last year...
Because we certainly could go the last week of September.
It was like the 28th.
Yeah.
It was the last full week, I think.
That's what I'm wondering. We certainly could go one more week. And at least then the family, you know what I mean?
Well, I would say not even do that. If it's good for teachers to do the 3 weeks, just go with that. But
just go with the messaging. Okay.
Go with the messaging.
Okay.
The little explanation, I think that solves the problem.
I mean, I certainly didn't mean to, you know, move the day or anything. It's just something that came up and I was curious about.
Lee easily could move to the 28th and 29th, though, too. So we'll take that into consideration. Either way, it's still going to be good for teachers. They just didn't want to wait till the end of October.
So those are the small tweaks.
Yeah, maybe that's a nice little compromise, real easy tweak that we can do. All right.
Okay. Any further questions on the school calendar?
So, Perry, I'm going to ask you, timing of this. So now that you have these, you'll probably start getting the feedback, and then maybe we can bring these back to the board. And about how much time did you give last year for your window,
so,
just so that the board knows?
The past couple of years, we sent the survey out. November, and we've gotten information back in early December, and you've made this what you've done the last couple of years. The only thing, George, I would ask you is, are there any other surveys that we're planning on sending out? Because I know we've got students doing Gallup survey right now, which I don't think is a
right
concern, but I didn't know if we had anything coming
up. Yeah, well, we'll ask school perceptions in January, so the earlier the better, probably for this one.
We can get it out right away.
Right.
The other thing I would remind everybody is the other group, we also survey staff.
Yep, we want to do that as well, right?
As well,
so we could probably make this decision in November this year, probably. Yep. Maybe the second meeting in November?
Yeah, we seem to
receive or early December, either one.
We seem to receive the most complaints. Is some people make them a year in advance. So mm-hmm. as long as they knew when before a year in advance for winter break, I think that was the biggest concern that I'd heard.
So we'll try to get out in November. We'll try to get it to you in November then.
That would be, what, the 14th, because the second board meeting has been moved up, so...
Okay, we'll get the feedback in to you by the 14th. Thank you.
Okay. Any further questions or concerns on the school calendar? Very good discussion on that. Protocol on concerns brought to board members. This one is actually a little more of an information type situation. I'm going to start it off and I'm going to turn it back over to George. I'm going to be sensitive to information. We had a board member receive an email concerning a very specific complaint with some very specific information, with kind of a push saying, if you don't do something, I'm going to go to the media type situation. Board member did a fantastic job, brought it to myself, brought it to George, and then George handled that. The nice thing about this was the concern after the investigation was done found some different information from what was originally communicated. So I'm going to stop talking here and let George talk. But again, I wanted to compliment, this is not a complaint. This is more of just a kind of a reminder about how to correctly handle, because we have had a couple high profile incidents we have with the LaPollet and things such as that. But it doesn't always necessarily come to the board president. Sometimes it comes to a board member and puts you in a difficult position. So, George.
Sure. Well, if you recall, in May, we actually talked about this during our board retreat, and I just want to compliment all of you. Anytime a concern has been brought, you've handled it perfectly. Where you've looped me in or one of the administrators in directly, connected us with the concerned person, or you brought the concern and shared it, and we're able to communicate it back, and it's gone very, very smoothly. So. In this particular situation, when the concern came to, I'm just going to use Linda because it came to Linda, and it was on a weekend even, and said, you know, I'm looping the superintendent in, the superintendent will get a hold of you. Contacted the parent via email, contacted Tabitha right away, contacted Lori right away, and the investigation actually started on a Sunday by just getting things ready to go for Monday morning. And so, the good news is that it was quick. We responded right away. The board member got it right to the correct person to get it going. And then we were able to loop the board member back in. I included Linda and Bob as to where we were at in the investigation so that they knew. We looped the parent back in, talked to parents. So my point is we handled it well. We got compliments from the parent how it was handled. So I think we can just do that so well when we work collaboratively. And so far, anytime, luckily we've only had a few, and you've done a great job as well, where you've had concerns brought to you. So we just wanted to use this as an example to say, well done, and that's how we can meet the needs of our families in a very efficient, effective, positive way.
And the reason I bring it up is, Linda had actually talked to me about this, and the initial message was a little strong, and she's like, well, wait a minute, how do I handle this? And as it ended up, there are some people who speak quietly and who address their concerns in a very quiet manner, and there are other people who address the exact same concern in a more aggressive manner. Doesn't mean the concern's any different, but when you're on the other side of that, especially if you're a newer board member, it does get a little intimidating. But just wanted to let you know the process does work well. You do get immediate attention from that. And also you have to keep in mind that you may actually have to weigh in on this. So you really don't want to be involved with the solution. You want to do as quickly as possible, turn it over to administration, and let them handle it. And
I'm going to say this, they've done an excellent job in terms of both timeliness as well as professionalism. So
it really does help when we're all able to work together in this particular situation. So, but it doesn't mean a whole lot when you're the person who gets this email or you're the one who gets this conversation, and all of a sudden you're like, oh, wait a minute. You know, you feel like somebody's shining a big, bright spotlight on you. You do get a lot of backup. You do get a lot of support from the administration. So I just wanted to pass it on, as well as to Linda's book. Very professional way you handled it.
March and the team responded. Yeah, I wasn't expecting to hear anything before Monday, but it's all resolved. And yeah, thank you.
Yeah, good job. Well, it's everybody here.
Yeah, did the bulk of it.
And it all reflects on the school district. You're able to take a very sticky situation, and as George mentioned, we got emails back from both the parents and other individuals saying thank you on the way it was handled. So that's tough. That's tough taking a negative situation and making it positive. So, again, I just want to pass that on. Any further questions, concerns? Okay. Items for actions. First reading of board policies 1A through 1C. John, and your team is, well.
We went through several of the policies. Policy one, we will be coming back to, because that one is still about, well, that one pertains to board goals, initiatives, or what is it?
Mission and vision.
Thank you. And that's still in the process of being worked out. So policy 1A, do we want to go through that? Or just highlight those modified changes? Okay. And what you'll find is most of these changes are minor. So in the second paragraph, changing the district is committed to providing a comprehensive and fiscally responsible educational program to the district will provide. Well, that's kind of redundant.
Well, the cross out should have continued to say.
Continuing on, we have the educational program shall assist students in understanding and mastering concepts and skills in developing critical thinking and problem-solving abilities. That's the proposed changes. Any comments on policy 1A? Okay.
So could I just add one kind of larger comment? Our goal wasn't to reinvent the wheel here. Our goal was just to make things more clear, essentially.
Yeah, so. I think that's important to note, is we're not rewriting these things. We're just issue spotting with that, so. Mm-hmm. Right. Yeah, right. Things change over time, so.
But what's the difference between skills and abilities? You know, when we say developing critical thinking and problem-solving abilities versus developing critical thinking and problem-solving skills.
I don't think if I'm understanding you, I don't think the word skills was there before. I think the mm-hmm. sentence ended in utilizing critical thinking and problem-solving. And so we just added ability.
Yeah, I know. I think my question is, does it make a difference if we use skill versus ability? Ability is a little bit depends on the individual students, right? Is that more subjective, whereas skills are?
Well, I think that's a urban one's more of a noun.
That's a good. I think it's a good suggestion what she's saying. The reason we just put a word in there at all is because there needed to be a word, you know, and problem solving is just. Needs a noun, so we wanted to add a noun, and we just came up with abilities, but I guess skills was something that would probably work too. Yep.
See, I was majoring in English.
Are you noting the changes? Sure. Okay.
That used to be weird.
Really?
She'd be weird.
Get your red pen out there.
It's good that we have someone keeping an eye on.
There's a little bit more changes to this one with the addition of a new paragraph. So in the first one, first paragraph, we are adding the board philosophy of governance recognizes the board's elected responsibility to represent the interests of the district's constituents without involving itself or engaging in the administrative operation of the school facilities or in the administration of the district's educational programs. Continuing on, we remove the word some. These policies will provide the board guidelines governing district programs and facilities while allowing flexibility for individual site operation. Continuing, all board policies will adhere to state and federal law pertaining to governance, management, operation, and any other issues involving schools. Moving down, the development, monitoring, and evaluation of board policies, as well as annual district, superintendent, and board goals, and including a comma after goals. And then further down, with the exception of board policies or goals specifically related to the organization and governance of itself, the board delegates exclusion of the responsibility of the execution of board policy, including removing comma, and goals to the superintendent or to his or her designees. And finally, adding, the superintendent will provide recommended annual goals to the district, to the board for its consideration in May. If determined necessary by the board, a subcommittee may be formed for further development of district goals and presented to the board as a whole in June for consideration. That ties in with the timelines.
Yep. So we did this year. Perfect.
Questions on 1B? Comments?
The only one I would have here, and I'm not certain, I didn't take a look to see just to make sure that on that last sentence that we put that in the annual agenda calendar. Okay, so if we need specific mention that, because sometimes we'll do this and then we'll go, oh, wait a minute, we missed it.
Moving on, philosophy of governance procedures, policy 1B.2, including in the second paragraph, when appropriate, goals is made lowercase. Because there may be different types of approaches towards goals development, not saying specifically calling out using the SMART approach. Annual district goals, the superintendent in collaboration with the board shall develop annual goal recommendations for the district as a whole. The goals are outcomes that the district intends to accomplish in a specific year, continues on. And then annual board goals, the board shall establish goals for itself, reflecting what it intends to accomplish in the course of a specific year. Any comments, suggestions on 1B2?
Just a little gloss on that. I think the idea was to just make a little bit more explicit the procedure and the relationship of the superintendent with the board with regard to district goals, because part of the policies talked about working and that the superintendent will consult with the board and develop annual goals for the district. But in other places, it seemed like more of a board function. So the paragraph we added was basically designed to be a little bit more explicit about how that's going to work. The superintendent will provide recommended annual goals for the district. And then later we talk about the superintendent in collaboration with the board shall develop annual goals recommendations for the district. So we thought we aligned that process and described it a little bit more accurately than it had been before. So that was no real substantive change was meant there, just a little bit more precise description to you guys.
Very helpful. Thank you.
Moving on to philosophy of governance procedures, procedure 1-B.3, budget oversight. change the first sentence to read, the board shall work with administration to develop an annual budget list of priorities and a long-range budget forecast. This was based upon a comment, what are the annual budget priorities that were included in the original first sentence? So this is a clarification of that sentence. And then there are some minor changes in the bullet points. The second one, the budget allocates sufficient resources to programs which improve student achievement and the in-service necessary to support these programs. And the last bullet point, the budget allocates resources to staff development and engagement activities. Once again, clarifying and enriching a little bit. Any comments on 1-B.3? And on policy 1-C, it was, we had done some work on this. It was brought up. Maybe there's an opportunity to enhance this a little bit more. So with the board's approval, I'd like to bring this back to the subcommittee for additional work, and we'll present this for a first reading the next time that we go through the policies. And that's all we have.
Well, at this point in time, this is an action item. So we are looking for, we do two readings. This will be the first reading. Any changes would be made at this time and be brought back for a second reading. So we'd be looking for a motion for approval of all of these with the exception of 1C, which will be brought back at a later time.
So moved.
Second. Any further questions, concerns? All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Okay, at this particular time, we have no further items on the agenda. Are there any other items that would, we do have an agenda committee coming up soon. Are there any items that would like to be included on the next agenda committee meeting? If you don't have any now, please feel free to forward those to anybody on the agenda committee or to George.
For consideration, that's October 17th.
We do have the round board, the board roundtable meeting on the 24th at 5:45. There'll be food will be served at that time, and then we'll have the regular board meeting at 7 o'clock. If we don't have anything else, then look for a move to adjourn.
So moved.
Second. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Thank you for the meeting.